changed it to a 14.
What's going on, you guys? Motorcycle Boss again. So this time, this is actually going to be a follow-up to the project I told you I was going to end up putting up from the last video, and it is steel braided brake lines. I am doing steel braided brake lines on my ZX10, and sorry if I look like I'm tired. I'm super tired, so I apologize. But this does take a little bit of time to do. As always, when it comes to brakes, I always advise that if you're not comfortable with doing anything brake related, definitely take it to a certified technician or a mechanic and have them do it for you. These are brakes, they're very important. If you mess them up, it can cost you your life, so it's very important. So the benefit of going with steel braided brake lines versus the rubber lines that come with factory on most motorcycles is over time, approximately 4 years is normally the lifespan of rubber lines, they begin to expand and swell as you apply brake pressure. So you start to get a spongy brake feel because not all of your braking pressure is going straight to the piston at the caliper with your brakes. It's actually making the lines expand, and that's where that spongy feeling starts to come. As you saw in my video prior, if you watched it, I had rebuilt my master cylinder in an attempt to think, you know, that might be what's causing it after a brake bleed. And in reality, it's just going to be that my lines are old. They're actually about 6 years old. This bike is a 2011 and it's 2017, so they're about 6 years old. So now it's time to upgrade to steel braided lines. And the steel braided lines have a steel braid literally all the way around the lines. So whenever you apply pressure and the inside of these lines are pressurized, they will not be allowed to expand. Thus, the pressure that you're applying will go straight to the brake calipers and give you a much more firm feel. So there is a process into going about this, so watch carefully, and yet again, if you're not comfortable, take it to a certified technician. Let's get to it. So I removed my windshield in order to make this a little bit easier to see. Because brake fluid is very nasty, we're gonna wrap this up real quick in a towel. We're gonna take the reservoir cap off. Now the whole point of this part is we're going to completely remove not just the reservoir but also the brake lines and calipers of all brake fluid. And this is the first part you start off at. And we'll put this back on temporarily. And now we will suck the fluid from the calipers. So we're gonna locate your bleed dimple as if you were to bleed your brakes. I do have a video on that and I'll post that in the description. So I'm gonna take the dust cap off and we are going to remove all the brake fluid in the brake line as well as what is in the caliper. And I have another caliper and brake line on the other side. I'm gonna end up doing the same thing on that side after this one. I'm using a pneumatic bleeder, so this is a bottle that's hooked up to my air compressor, and that just makes this job a little bit faster, but you can use a regular line in a bottle and use the squeeze pump technique, that's just fine. So if you don't know what this is, you don't have to really worry about it. If you watch my brake bleeding video, it'll explain the difference between the two. Now we're gonna cinch that back up. I'm gonna do the same thing to the other side. So now we're going to remove the brake line from the caliper. And right here, we can see that there's a nut holding that in place. So we're just gonna undo that. And I already got my rag ready to roll. So we're just gonna take this off. We already sucked all the fluid out, so there shouldn't be a whole lot leaking out. And you should have a washer
on one side if it wants to come off. And washer on the other side. Gotta get that one off too. Alright. Set that aside. Now I've got my rag to absorb any excess brake fluid. I'm just going to shove that through here. So now we'll disconnect it up here. It's higher up. It's going to have a connector right up there. So we're going to disconnect that. And yet again, if you have brake fluid on your fingers, be careful on touching painted surfaces. No one's going to see back here, so I don't care too much. And there may be a clip further up there that's holding it in place, like a clamp or something. Just undo that as well. And now we're going to, I already unbolted the opposite side. Now we're gonna unbolt from the master cylinder up top. So this is where the brake line attaches to the bottom of the master cylinder. So make sure you have a towel underneath this. We're gonna crack that one loose. Alright, so we have this section that is where these two are actually going to go with one bolt to hold it to the master cylinder. And as the line goes down, it splits into two cables. And one will go to the left side, and one will go to the right side. So it's really critical that I go over this with you as far as how these banjo bolts is what they're called. And fitting the washers work out as far as the order that they go in. So for the master cylinder, we're going to be using this one. And if you notice, in the bottom of the bolt, it's going to have a hole. And on the side of the bolt, it's going to have a hole there. And there's a hole right there as well. And if you look inside these fittings, you'd be able to see that there's a hole inside here. And then there's a channel all the way around in the center of this fitting. So what happens is, where this hole is, if we were to set it in here like this, basically the brake pressure that's coming from the master cylinder would go through that bottom hole, and then it would get transferred through the line through the side of the bolt, and that's how this works. This particular bolt is set up to accept two lines for the master cylinder. And it's incredibly important as far as the order that these go in. So you will start with a copper crush washer that's included in this particular kit. You'll slide that all the way down to the bottom. You will get your first fitting. You'll get another copper crush washer. You get your second fitting. And then you'll get another copper crush washer. And then this whole thing will get screwed into the master cylinder, which would be here. And this is gonna be upside down, so it would be more so like this. And it would get screwed into the master cylinder this way. So remember that. As well as for these lines, this is only for one for one banjo bolt, one banjo fitting. So it's gonna go the kind of the same thing. We're gonna get one crush washer. This one's gonna go through, and then we're gonna get another copper washer, and that gets threaded onto the caliper. Same thing for the other side as well. So this is the order that they go in. Do not forget this step, otherwise you could get leaky brakes and it could fail on you. So make sure you do this right. Sorry if this is hard to see, but I'm screwing this in by hand until it comes to a stop. I'm not going to actually tighten this down until I get everything in the system connected. So now that this is finished, we're going to move down to one of the calipers and we're going to do that side. So I already bolted the other one on the opposite side. So now it's to get this line through here. Just make sure your routing is correct. Now we're going to have our bolt, which is our new bolt. We're going to have a crush washer. Our banjo fitting. And then another washer. And this will go onto here. We're just going to thread that in by hand. Now that this is good, check your routing and make sure that everything on this line has been routed properly further up the system. Make sure the routing is good further up the system. We have this little grommet thing right here that's gonna fit right into this right here. So make sure you're good there. Also, turn the steering wheel left and right and pay attention to your master cylinder banjo bolts. Now that those are sticking out a little bit further, just keep an eye on those. And then we're actually gonna torque these down for this particular bike is gonna be 216 inch pounds or pounds, inches, whatever you wanna call it. So make sure you're good there. And as you tighten them down, be sure that you are holding them in place. So let's move forward from there. So I'm gonna torque all these down off camera, all these pieces here and the master cylinder ones. And I'll get back to you afterwards. So I got all of the banjo bolts torqued down to spec. I put all the grommets in the right place and I basically made sure the routing was right. I turned the steering wheel I turned the handlebars a few times and made sure that had full range of motion. Nothing was binding, nothing was getting crimped or anything. And then I also balanced the suspension to make sure that there's gonna be enough play. It's not gonna be tugged, nothing's under tension. Once that's all good to go and ready to roll, now you're ready to fill the system back up with fluid. And I know some people that are mechanically inclined may be thinking, why didn't I prime the system? And if you don't know what that is, priming is basically where you, before you put the master cylinder banjo bolt on, you fill the top reservoir with brake fluid and you pump the brakes and you cover that hole the banjo fitting was on with your finger until you feel pressure, and then you release some of the air until you get fluid. Once you get fluid, then you put the banjo bolt on. And basically what that does is that removes any air in the master cylinder. So the reason I didn't do that is because I've never had a problem with it as long as you do this method. And sometimes if you prime it, you will still have to do what I'm gonna do now. So I'd rather just get it out of the way, do it the first time. So the trick is this. So first off, we're gonna get some fresh brake fluid. And we're gonna fill up the reservoir, fill it up all the way to the top. And now we're going to hook some lines up to each caliper, and we're basically gonna do a gravity bleed for about an hour. But I'll show you what that looks like. So now what you're gonna do is you're gonna go down to each caliper, and you're going to take a silicone hose, and you're going to put it on the bleed nipple. I'm gonna crack it open. You're going to do this exact same thing to the other side if you have another one, or if you only have access to one tube, you can do it for just one side at a time, but I recommend doing both.
So what we're doing now is we're doing what's called a gravity bleed. And I only have to do this normally if I'm changing brake lines or changing calipers, but basically there is passages in the calipers that are very hard to bleed. And if you tried to immediately bleed it, you would most likely have air in the system that you can't get out. And this right here will actually just about ensure that you will get it out. So make sure you have a decently full reservoir, and you're gonna actually give it about 10 pumps or so. Watch your reservoir, about 10 to 20 pumps. So now you're going to let this sit, and you're going to want to come back, check on it periodically because this level will drop. Just make sure it doesn't get all the way to the down where it's going to start to suck air. So go ahead and just, you know, go grab a snack or something. If you're doing one caliper at a time, it's going to take a lot longer. This is actually moving fairly quickly, but this is just a waiting game at this point. So just check on it periodically. For me, I'm doing two calipers. So once this drops down, I'm going to fill it up and wait again. And I'll get back to you guys once that's done. All right, so it's been a little bit since I let this kind of drain. I actually filled it up about four times just to ensure that it had adequate time for those passages to fill. And I also, once I cap those off, I did do a bleeding, and you're supposed to be doing a bleeding afterwards after you let it gravity bleed for a second and ensure that you got all the air out that you can. So I bled the two bottom ones, and then afterwards I bled the top one. Of course, if you want to learn how to bleed brakes, I will put a video at the end of this video, or I'll put a link in the description so you can learn that. But making this one the last one, so the bubbles, when they float up, they kind of accumulate up here, and I could probably get them out of here. So now that that's all said and done, I actually do have some firm brake pressure. So it's all good now. So I'm going to top this up to the approximate level it was at before we started, or depending on your brake pad life, you would want, if your brake pads are near shot, you might want to set it to the low level. If you just replaced your brake pads not that long ago, set it to the high level. And then if you don't know where your brake pads are at, probably better off setting them medium to low, roughly. But just make sure you keep an eye on it. So I'm gonna kind of top that off a little bit, put the cap on, and then we're gonna throw a zip tie on this and let it sit overnight, so that way we can pressurize any existing bubbles and have them float up to the top. And then once the next day comes, you're gonna clip that zip tie, and then all the bubbles that were accumulated up here should pop up, and then you should get a real nice firm brake pedal. And that's how you change brake lines. Just an added note, make sure that you inspect all of your fittings after you have bled your system. Make sure you inspect all your fittings and make sure that there are no leaks from underneath the master cylinder or wherever yours bolts to the master cylinder, down at the calipers, and make sure that your bleed nipples are good and tight. Last thing you need is to go out on your first ride and your brakes fail. So just make sure you check for any leaks. So that's how you guys install steel braided lines. Now, every bike is going to be a little bit different as far as the master cylinder placement. Maybe if you wanted to go from a one line from the master cylinder down to the caliper, and then have two line, have another line jump off of that one onto the other side. There's different setups. The steel braided brake lines that I used in this video was from a company called Core Moto, and they specialize in making steel braided lines. And the cool thing about them is you can actually take like two plastic pens if the angle of the banjo fittings don't line up perfectly. You can put two plastic pens through each end and then just twist it, and they actually rotate, and it doesn't void the warranty or anything like that. They're still just as strong as they were from the factory, but that's just an added bonus of going with a Core Moto line. Plus, you can customize the colors completely. I'm not paid for this. This is off of my own research. They're not sponsoring this video whatsoever, but from the research I've done, Galfer is another good company. However, Coromoto gives you the most customizable options from colors of the logo, the lines, and the fitting, which I thought was pretty nice. So I was able to get the natural steel and the white logo with the silver ends. I thought that went with my bike pretty well. Actually, it does look pretty nice. But now I still have the zip tie on the brake. We're gonna let this sit overnight, and then in the morning we'll just cut it, and then we should be good to go from there. Just be careful on the first ride and just make sure that everything's working properly first. So take it slow and then work your way up from there. This is a brake job, so be sure that you have a qualified technician handle it if you're not comfortable with this job. And otherwise, tackle it on your own, and good luck. And I hope you guys like this video. Please like, subscribe, and definitely comment. I'd like to know what you guys think about this video. If you have any questions, feel free to let me know. Thanks.